welcome to week four of Isn't It Romantic? Now, to start today's class, I'm going to do a little bit of a listening quiz. Exciting times. And I'm going to play three excerpts. And I would like you to identify the composer that is being played and or the piece that is being played. Now, you can write it down in the chat or you can just keep it to yourself. Either way, all I want you to do is to just get an understanding of the work and see what it is. So here we go. Here's the first excerpt, and it's quite short. Okay, so that's the first one. The second one is... Okay, did you get in your mind which one that was? Here we go, here's the third and final excerpt for the quiz. That's all I'm playing for that one. So, anyone? Good. We've got some answers coming in. Here we go. So the first one, yes, was Dvorak's New World Symphony, the last movement, the fourth movement. The second one was Smetana, the Moldau, yes, Mavlast. And you've got it, Tchaikovsky Piano Concerto number one. Good. So this, now the reason why I just have to get out of this here, that I brought those up or played those examples was those are probably the most famous works that those composers wrote, right? The New World Symphony, Dvorak's Ninth Symphony, we know it. The Piano Concerto by Tchaikovsky. If you would play that to just a general population that had even no musical or classical music background, they could probably say, hey, I've heard that somewhere. They might not say it's Tchaikovsky or the Piano Concerto, but they probably heard that somewhere before. And also even Smetana's Moldau or Mavlast, which is probably the most famous thing that he ever wrote. But of course, Dvorak and Tchaikovsky wrote other great, great works. And so did Smetana. Smetana wrote some wonderful chamber music. He wrote operas, other symphonic works, but we often, not just in classical music, or not just in the popular world, but also in classical music, we tend to lean or navigate towards the things that we know and play those over and over. And there's so much music that we can dive into, and I know this class is specifically geared towards the symphonic music, but even those composers, like Tchaikovsky wrote 6 symphonies, Dvorak wrote 9 symphonies. And another reason why we're not gonna dive into those ones today is because I covered them in spring in my course there. But I want to explore music that these wonderful composers produce that we don't hear so much about. Now, of course, people play Dvorak the 8th symphony and even more Tchaikovsky's 5th symphony, but the other two are played much more often. And I also wanted to continue on the idea from last week about nationalism and the pride of a composer's homeland and how that influenced their music. For instance, last week we talked about Rimsky-Korsakov and the whole Russian influence. And I mentioned a bit about Tchaikovsky in there as well, and how he kind of got mixed up in that whole world. And yes, Tchaikovsky definitely was in there. And like Rimsky-Korsakov, he didn't have that much formal training. Actually, back in that time in Russia, to become a musician was not really a good career plan or a career path, because the social status of a musician at the time was pretty low, close to a peasant even, because a lot of musicians were folk musicians, maybe taught a little bit or played in a theater, but it was usually a folk theater. And that's because the whole Western tradition, the Western European tradition, had not in any way taken hold in Russia until about the mid-1800s, which is incredibly late when you consider what was happening in Western Europe. So you know about, of course, the Baroque era and the Renaissance era with, you know, Baroque with Bach and Vivaldi and Handel. That was in the 1600s, and of course there's much music before that, but those institutions, the church, the courts, all of that were packed full of a long, long history of composed music, of composers, not necessarily high rank, but they at least composed for the court, for the church, and also on their own as well. But that tradition was not there in Russia at all. And it only really came in the 1860s. We touched on it briefly last week, but the St. Petersburg Conservatory, and then a couple of years later, the Moscow Conservatory, only started in the early 1860s. And that was because the Tsar at the time, who had a wife who was involved in Western culture, Western European culture, I should say, wanted more of that. And he thought it would be a good idea to import a lot of those ideas into Russia. Now, of course, this conflicted with a lot of Russian traditions and what they felt was their pride. But this came to be. And the two people that did it were brothers, Anton and Nikolai Rubinstein, not to be confused with Arthur Rubinstein, the famous pianist of the 1900s. But these two started these conservatories. And Tchaikovsky, he actually was in the very, very first class of the St. Petersburg Conservatory. When he was young, he went to school to be a civil servant. That's what you did in certain families. And his family was well versed in this. They had been doing this for a while. And he had a bit of musical talent. But like a lot of the composers from that time and place, it wasn't that exceptional, but he learned very quickly when he was older. And when the St. Petersburg Conservatory came into being, he said, "Hey, I'm going to enroll in that and see if I can blossom this love of music that I have." And soon after he graduated, he actually became the first music theory teacher of the very new Moscow Conservatory. So from the beginning, he was involved in that. Remember Rimsky-Korsakov, he got involved a bit later. Tchaikovsky was right in from the beginning. And that, of course, caused much consternation to those composers. We talked about them, the five from last week, who wanted that Russian tradition, that anti-academic tradition of the Western Europeans. And so this conflict within Tchaikovsky was with him for his whole life. It was a bit there with Rimsky-Korsakov, but Tchaikovsky took the Western level, the Western tradition to a whole new level with his influence of the Russian folk lore and folk music. And so there was this battle back and forth, as we're going to see later on. And so even though he did get a job at the Moscow Conservatory, he did not make a lot of money. It did not pay him very well. So he had to get some other jobs. He did a little bit of teaching piano, but he also was a music critic. And this didn't pay him a lot, but it actually got him to travel a lot. And one really interesting event or concert that he reviewed was the opening and the very first performance of Richard Wagner's The Ring Cycle. So Tchaikovsky traveled to Germany, to Bayreuth, the small town, which to this very day, well, not this year because of COVID, but to this very day, there's a festival in the summer in Bayreuth, which was specially built in this theater to house Wagner operas. Well, Tchaikovsky was there and got to review this. He actually didn't like the Ring Cycle. They're very, very long, of course. He liked some of the music, but he didn't really love the whole thing of it. But eventually he started getting his works performed. And the very, very first thing that ever was performed of his in public was conducted by none other than Johann Strauss II, the Waltz King. You know, the Radetzky March, all the Viennese waltzes. That's Johann Strauss II. And he conducted Tchaikovsky's first musical performance, which was a nice little tie-in. So to this day, we think often in the classical music world, at least in terms of the performance, we think, oh, well, Strauss waltzes are, they're popular. They're, you know, over here, whereas Brahms and Beethoven and Tchaikovsky are more elevated. Well, I love how this mixed at the time with all these living composers and conductors and all went hand in hand. And in fact, Brahms was very, he loved Strauss waltzes, by the way. And so in terms of producing more of his works, he also got into conducting. Now we've noticed this ever since Berlioz and then Mendelssohn and further on, this whole thing of composers conducting their own works was a thing. It wasn't in the Baroque times. I mean, most Baroque, there weren't really conductors. They were just leading from the harpsichord or leading from one of the other instruments. But this whole thing of conducting tradition became more and more prominent. And so Tchaikovsky, to get his works performed, he traveled more and more as a conductor, and he traveled to Western Europe and to other places. And not only in Europe, but he also went to the US. And this is a really fascinating thing with Tchaikovsky, but he actually opened, he was part of the first concert of Carnegie Hall. So Carnegie Hall opened in 1891 by, of course, Andrew, well, back then he was Carnegie, but Carnegie opened this hall in 1891, and he wanted Tchaikovsky to come over, not only from Europe, but from Russia. I mean, Russia is Europe, but he had to go even that much further, all the way to New York, and presented one of his works there at the opening of the hall, which is a wonderful connection. But because he went to Carnegie Hall to open the hall, he actually missed in Russia the premiere of the Nutcracker Suite, which I was going to play the Nutcracker at the beginning because that's probably also one of his most famous works. But it's so interesting that probably one of the most famous halls in the world for classical music, Carnegie Hall, and one of the most famous classical works, the Nutcracker, there's a very strong link between those two. But during his lifetime, he got more and more famous. And by the end, the Tsar at the time, Tsar Alexander III, he gave him a lifetime pension. So he didn't really have to worry that much about money later on. Earlier, yes, of course, but not later on. And so as a composer, he was quite successful. But like I said, there's always that dichotomy between Russia and the Western world, even more so than Rimsky-Korsakov, because he wanted to be that Western composer. He wanted to be that Brahms or Beethoven. And so composing-wise, he was quite successful. Personal life, not necessarily as much as his professional life. He came from a very loving family in terms of his siblings. He was very, very close to his brother Modest, and Modest's twin sister, and some of his other siblings. They became, they were close throughout his life, which was very helpful because he was a gay man living in late 1800s Russia, which was not necessarily a good thing to be back then, and still in Russia to this day is actually not a great place to be open and out. And so this weighed on him heavily. There's conflicting reports. There's some biographers that say he was actually open about it and not ashamed, and others have said that it's really weighed down on him throughout his life. But one thing we know is that he did marry, actually, because of the pressures of society. He did marry But it was disastrous. They were only together for 2.5 months and then he left. And he knew right from the beginning this was not the right thing that he should have done. And he never blamed his wife. He said it just didn't work out. But a relationship that did really work out was this older widow who was quite wealthy because her husband had been a railway magnate. She got to know Tchaikovsky just through writing letters, and they had a 13-year correspondence and relationship where she gave him money to produce works and were commissioned him to write a lot of these works and supported him financially. But the one thing about their relationship that they both agreed on is that they would never, ever meet in person. And they never did. For those 13 years, they're very, very close. They wrote wonderful letters. It was completely platonic, of course. But it was a healthy relationship in that way, which he could pour out his emotions and get support from her. And it was something that actually worked out well in his life. We heard a bit of, we actually did not hear it, but in spring we heard his sixth symphony, and 9 days after the premiere of his sixth symphony, he died, just 9 days afterwards. And that actually lends some gravitas to that symphony as well. That's why there's more commotion and story around it, because they say he died of cholera, but many historians think he also committed suicide. Or committed suicide. So we're not really sure. There's good arguments for both, but it probably wasn't a happy ending, to say the least. And so he died after his sixth symphony, but his fifth symphony was very, very popular. And he conducted the premiere. We talked about the way composers got their works known and conducted their own works. And so he did this with the Mravinsky Theater, which to this day is still there. It's still a very, very successful theater. And one thing that he did in this work, all four movements, is that he played, or he wrote in, a recurring theme that comes every single movement. Now, before I show you that, I'm going to play each of these recurring themes. So here's the first one. It plays right off the beginning. Listen to the clarinets in this. Good. So you could hear that in the clarinet. Here we go. Here's the second one. Good, so that's the second one from the second movement, a bit louder than the first one. And here's the third one, I'm gonna get it lined up. So you notice there that it's a completely different rhythm, it's completely different character, but it's the same, and different key as well, but same theme. And here is the last one. ¶¶ similarities between all of those themes, and how he brilliantly brought them back in a couple of movements. He kind of snuck them in, but we're going to also go through a bit of each movement. And the fourth movement, I'm going to save the best to the last, the coda. So coda is the ending of a movement where they kind of wrap things up, and it's a denouement in a way, but like a it can be very fiery and big, and in this case it certainly is in the fourth movement. But let's go back to the first movement. So that was the version of the fourth movement. That's the main theme. And Tchaikovsky, one of his characteristics of writing in a Western European tradition is the symphonic works of his, the symphonies, are very similar. So we have a fast first movement. We've got a bit of a slower second movement. We've got a scherzo or minuet and trio type third movement, and then a faster fourth movement. And in good writing of the Western European tradition, the first movement is in something called the Allegro sonata form. Now, I'm not going to go into theory of what that is, but the structure of it basically is there's three parts. The first one is called the exposition. The second one is the development. And the third one is the recapitulation. So the first one, the exposition is where you have one or two, sometimes three themes. So that first theme that you heard, and then maybe another theme. And what you do is you play them, and then you link them together with some link music, I suppose, to another theme. And then when you get to the exposition, you usually have a repeat. You should go back to the beginning, play it all over again so people can get acquainted with the themes. And then the development is just as it states, is where they take the themes from the beginning and they develop them. They change them around, they shorten them, they lengthen them, they change keys, all the stuff. And then in the recapitulation, you recap everything from the beginning in a different key because you have to end the piece. But you take that beginning, all those themes, and play in a different key at the end. And so that's basically what a sonata allegro form is. And Tchaikovsky and a lot of composers that were steeped in the folk tradition had a very difficult time with this, because the folk tradition is, even in larger works like the Rimsky-Korsakov, you play a theme, a main theme, and then you basically do variations on that theme. So you might play it a step higher. You might play it a step lower in terms of the pitch. You might do different instrumentation the second or third or fourth time around. So it's kind of this plateau of music, and the listener gets to know it, but is not tired by the same thing because you change it a bit here and there. But in sonata allegro form, you've got to change it, or you've got different themes. You've got to develop those themes. So Tchaikovsky, what he actually did was he did have first and second and third themes, but often he would take the main theme and then repeat it up a step or repeat it down a step and then change slightly different orchestration. So he married the Western tradition with the Russian tradition. And what I'm going to do now is share the screen so that we can see this. Here we go. Tchaikovsky's Fifth Symphony, and I have it there as the recurring theme. So let's listen to that again. And we're going to go through the beginning of it, and you're going to hear all of this. So listen to the clarinet and then the low, low strings. Here we go. Here's the first movement. Notice the dynamic changes. We're here. Crescendo, get louder. now. In comes again. Just to skip ahead a little bit to the first theme. There's that beautiful main recurring theme, recurring theme. And then he starts with a main theme that has that Russian tradition, that dance like, so what he's doing is a beautiful introduction, something like Brahms would do or Beethoven. And then he adds that Tchaikovsky Russian element to it. And so, The second movement is, we're talking about that Western European tradition. The second movement grabs that tradition and holds on for dear life. And what it is one of the most beautiful, beautiful melodies of classical music. And Tchaikovsky is known for these. Tchaikovsky, Dvorak, they have these beautiful, long, long melodies that probably come from their tradition of folk music. And in this instance, it's been used in other popular culture things. For instance, none other than what's his name? Sunshine on My Shoulders. Oh my goodness. Anyway, a folk singer from the US. John Denver, thank you. Someone had it there, I love that. John Denver, the Annie song, I think it is what it is. It's the exact same melody. Now, apparently, John didn't know that it was this melody, but you'll hear, if you know John Denver's song, any song, they're the same. So here it is. There's a slow introduction or a little bit of an introduction, and then listen to the horn, and you'll recognize it immediately. Tchaikovsky was in no way afraid to let his emotions show and to go to places where some people might consider it a bit cheesy. But this is the beauty of Tchaikovsky. This is, he unabashedly poured forth these melodies, the wonderful orchestration. You probably can't hear it, but the second horn is going, bottom, 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 beautifully. And it's not that you can, it's not that you have to hear that, but it's a beautiful underlying thing that emphasizes this gorgeous straight melody. And so this is very much Tchaikovsky. I was also gonna play one of his tone poems called Romeo and Juliet, where there's a famous viola and English horn solo that everyone knows is played on and around Valentine's Day and a lot of commercials selling romantic wares. But this is very much Tchaikovsky. And so this is this dichotomy between using that expressive, emotive side that came from his Russian side and mixing it with that Western style, which Brahms would never be that open necessarily with a melody. He would somehow cleverly disguise it or somehow change it slightly so it's not so so out there. Alina has a great question. Can you do multiple themes in the same piece? Yes, you can. We're gonna get into that in the Dvorak. But here, for instance, what just started was a second theme. I'll just continue on to answer your question. So you heard the beautiful melody. Now this is the second theme. It has nothing to do with the first. Listen to this. It uses a bit of the horn, but there's the oboe in there, and the strings are going da 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 da. It's a completely different melody, but he joined it with the first theme as well. So thanks, Alina, for that question. Now we're gonna not skip, but the third movement is a wonderful waltz. Tchaikovsky are famous for them, of course, all those ballets, Swan Lake, Nutcracker, you name it. Tchaikovsky was brilliant at ballets. But you heard the beginning of the fourth movement, dum, ja da dum, ba da dum, ba, ba, da da dum, da da dum, da. And what I'm going to play now is what I alluded to before, which is the coda. It's the end of the piece. And it lasts for about a minute and a half, 2 minutes. And this coda actually it kind of sums up the style of Tchaikovsky in a way. He himself was not exactly pleased with this coda, and he thought it was way over the top, a bit too cheesy, a bit too bombastic. And the person that he dedicated this piece to was a German man. And this German, he was an old, old person that brought Tchaikovsky over to Germany, to Hamburg, to present some concerts. And the old man really enjoyed Tchaikovsky, but he thought that he should move to Germany to be a truly German composer, because he thought Tchaikovsky, and this is Tchaikovsky quoting this person. And he said, you know, this Herr Ave Lallemont, openly confessed that there was a lot in my works which had been performed that was not to his liking, that he could not stand my noisy instrumentation, that he hated some of the orchestral effects which I resorted to, especially with regard to percussion. But all the same, he saw in me the markings of a truly German composer. I thought that was very German of someone to say, well, you know, you could change some things and become a better composer. But actually Tchaikovsky took that to heart in certain ways, but still there's a lot of bombastic characteristics to his music. So I'm gonna play a bit of that. This is the coda, and you're gonna hear that main theme come back as well. ¶¶ the end, but where I want to spend some time on Dvorak as well. But listen to that. Go to the playlist. Listen to it. It gets even crazier. It gets faster, and there's a lot of percussion involved. And that's, I had mentioned the second movement being cheesy in a certain way. Beautiful, wonderful, but some might consider it cheesy. This is cheesy in the opposite way in terms of like full-on bombastic pouring forth of music. And I often think that Tchaikovsky would have made a great film composer if he lived in this era, because he can really get to the emotions and get people to feel a lot of different things. Now Dvorak, Antonin Dvorak, he was of course Czech, but he was different from Tchaikovsky in that he grew up in the Austro-Hungarian Empire. So he had a lot of influence from Vienna, even though he was born in the Czech Republic, or it wasn't the Czech Republic back then, but Bohemia, and he loved his homeland of Bohemia. But there was still influence of the whole Austro-Hungarian Empire there. So he had, from the beginning, a lot more of that Western education and a lot more of the Western influence than, say, the folk music. He was still very versed in the folk music of Moravia and Bohemia and others as well. And he used a lot of that because he was very proud Bohemian. But he was able to process it and integrate it in a much more seamless way than, say, other composers trying to do the same thing. So like I said, he was born in Bohemia. He, like Tchaikovsky, was a bit of a musical kid, but not that exceptional. But he learned the organ and violin and piano and some theory as well. And he actually later on wanted to be a full-time professional organist. You notice how organists, also like Bruckner and others, became composers, and that might have something to do with, at your disposal in an organ, you have all the stops. You literally can pull out all the stops. And these stops are listed: trumpet, trombone, and of course they don't sound exactly like those instruments. They're very close. And also you have a keyboard here, you've got a keyboard here, and pedals at your feet. So you've got a whole bunch of different lines. And so this bodes well if you want to compose something and then orchestrate it, because you're sitting there at the organ actually already deciding, ooh, I'm going to pull the oboe stop, do this melody, I'm going to do this or this. And so they're really composing already and orchestrating at the same time if you're an organist. But he also played viola, which is, and very well and professionally. In fact, to make money when he was younger, he was part of this theater troupe and a small group of musicians, and they became so good and known that the Bohemian Provisional Theater, or theater, which is basically opera, hired them as a full-time orchestra. And so Dvorak was actually the principal violist of this orchestra for many years until he was about 30. And then at that time, he decided to devote most of his time to composing. And he, you know, eked out a living. He gave some piano lessons as well, and some organ, playing organ here and there. But he really wanted to make it as a composer. So he gave up his orchestra job. He got married, but in Mozart fashion, he did not marry his true love. He married his true love's sister. But that was actually a very successful marriage. And actually one of his daughters married the Czech composer Josef Suk. I don't know if you know some of his works, but they're wonderful. Talk about other composers that should be more well-known in certain ways, and that's one of them. But it was only until when he was 31 that his first work was ever performed in public. It was his piano quintet, which is a wonderful work. But a few years later, when he was, I think, 34, he entered a contest called the Austrian State Prize, which was in Vienna. But he sent in a work there. And this was a prize that was set up by the Ministry of Education for young, poor, gifted musicians. I love that. They just put the poor in there. So you needed money And he actually won. And little did he know that Brahms was actually on that jury. And so he entered again a couple of years later, and then again 3 years later, and he won all three times. And Brahms was so enamored by Dvorak's music that he passed on these works to, or introduced Dvorak to his publisher, Simrock. So Brahms published all this stuff with Simrock. And Simrock took a look at Dvorak's works and said, hey, I'll take these immediately. He published them, and they became very successful. So it was a financial gain, not only for the publisher, but for Dvorak as well. And this gained him, of course, international, or at least more of an international reputation. So he was on his way to composing for a livelihood, which continued for the rest of his life. He actually became quite well known and famous. He was the first Czech composer to be internationally famous during his lifetime. And not only did he compose and conduct, he was also a conductor in a lot of Europe, but he also went to the US as well, almost exactly the same time as Tchaikovsky. It was about a year later, in 1892. But he was there to actually be the director of a new conservatory called the National Music Conservatory in New York City. And this was set up by a wealthy woman who wanted to set up a very large conservatory that had some of the most famous names in music teaching there. But the conservatory was unusual because not only did it admit the normal clientele, men, but it also admitted women and people of color. African Americans were welcome as well, which was very unusual at the time. This is the late 1890s. And this woman who started the conservatory got Tchaikovsky there to spend 3 years in New York City, part of it because of the wage. So he got $15,000 per year. $15,000 in 1892 money is just shy of $500,000 today. So he was making some good, good coin when he was director of the conservatory there. And while he was there, he got very interested in indigenous music and also American African-American spirituals. And he promoted the idea that this should be the basis of American classical music. He said, you've got some wonderful music here. This should be the basis of what can develop into a national sound. It didn't really pick up that way, and in certain other ways it did. Some of the spirituals went into jazz and to other things, but the classical music world never really caught on to that idea or wanted that idea, to be frank. They didn't want that. And so, but while he was there, he wrote his ninth symphony, his New World Symphony, of course, well titled. And he also spent a little bit of time in Spillville, Iowa. That's where a small Czech community was, and he went out there for a summer and composed out there as well. But later on in life, he had to return to the Czech Republic because he was so homesick and he loved his part there. Although at some point near the end of Brahms's life, about a year before Brahms died, he begged Dvorak to come live in Vienna because he said, I need a counterbalance to this Bruckner guy. Come on, come live in Vienna, and we can be of the same ilk and conquer Vienna. Well, Brahms had already conquered Vienna, and so did Dvorak, but he wanted that companionship there. He never did. He stayed in the Czech Republic. But the Eighth Symphony is his kind of devotion and kind of a musical postcard to his homeland. From beginning to finish, it's just full of pleasure. And there's so much inspiration from folk music. There's not a lot of angst in it. There's bird calls. There's wonderful. It's just a very, very pleasurable work that should be played more often. It's gorgeous. And for the publishing rights, Zimrock, who by this time had published everything that Dvorak wrote, he offered Dvorak a much smaller fee than he usually gave him. And that was because he wanted Dvorak to compose or publish smaller works that were financially more successful. He didn't want another symphony. Well, Dvorak balked at this and said, "What, are you kidding me?" And he went to an English composer where he got 5 times more money than he did in Zimrock. Zimrock and Dvorak made up, and years later they published a lot of they got their publishing relationship back in order. But this symphony is just wonderful. And listen to the beginning, and you'll know exactly what I'm talking. This is the bird call. Listen to the bird call. Hear just complete joy of that music and how it's just sitting it up here, how there's this Brahmsian feel in a way, but with that Czech music. If you listen closely, the difference between Tchaikovsky's symphony and Dvorak's symphony, Dvorak, it's very well structured, and the instrumentation itself is concise and brings out exactly what he wants to bring out. Tchaikovsky is a bit more like this, if that seems a bit vague, but that's what it is. And Dvorak is a bit more manicured, I could say. I'm thinking about a lawn, manicured lawn. And there's a subtle Brahmsian way to it. And of course, that's his upbringing with the Austrian-Hungarian Vienna influence. The second movement is very pastoral and very beautiful. And the third movement is the epitome of a bohemian folk song. And there's two themes to it. I'm going to let it play so that you hear both themes. And I'm going to stop it when it gets to the second theme. But it's going to take a few minutes. But listen to the beginning of this and just picture yourself in the middle of a bohemian meadow. Skip ahead to the second theme, also very folk-like. Mm-hmm. So you hear those two themes, and Alina, this is to your question before, can we have two different themes? Yes, right here in the third movement, in the 3-4 dance type movement, you've got two separate themes. And he brings them back, he actually brings another in and recaps it all at the end. And so, oh my goodness, is that not folk music, dance music there? Just absolutely gorgeous. And the fourth movement there's a fanfare at the beginning. And this fanfare is not necessarily a Russian fanfare. It's more another type of call. And the conductor, Rafael Kubelek, who's a Czech conductor, who actually is the conductor of these recordings that you're hearing, at least the Dvorak. This is the Berlin Philharmonic with Kubelek. And this is back from the 70s, I think, or maybe early 80s. And the Tchaikovsky, by the way, was with the Marinsky Orchestra with Gergiev, the Russian conductor conducting that. But Kubelek, once he was conducting, I think it was the Concertgebouw in Amsterdam, and he said in rehearsal to the brass section, the gentleman in the brass section, he said, "Gentlemen, in Bohemia, the trumpets never call to battle. They always call to the dance." And you'll understand what this is. So it's an opening trumpet call, and then you get into this gorgeous, gorgeous melody, which is kind of a theme and variations, and then it goes into another theme. So listen to this. Develops in a bit. I'm going to play a little bit more of the coda. So the coda I talked about in Tchaikovsky in the fourth movement, it wraps everything up. And in the same way, Dvorak wraps everything up, but it's not, it is still bombastic in a certain way, but there's not as much of that here in Dvorak as we've heard in the Tchaikovsky. So listen to the end of this whole movement. Isn't that wonderful? Isn't that wonderful? Now, of course, it is full on a joy at the end, but you can see how it's kind of halfway between the Tchaikovsky one and what you hear in a coda of a Brahms symphony. And it's still well written, but it's still full on folk music. So I love how Dvorak really does a wonderful job of mixing in those two worlds. Of course, it's his own world. It's his, not to compare him to Brahms or Tchaikovsky. He is, of course, himself as a composer. Yeah, so that really kind of wraps up Tchaikovsky and Dvorak. Tchaikovsky and Dvorak, by the way, they met in Prague a bit. And of course, you know, the connection between Brahms and Dvorak. So like I said earlier, there's a lot of connection between these people. Rimsky-Korsakov was, of course, good friends with Tchaikovsky. They all knew of each other. They all knew each other. Dvorak played actually under Wagner when he was a violist in the Pit Orchestra in Prague. So there's these wonderful, wonderful connections. Any questions or anything else? Mark. Oh, that is definitely a wonderful cubic recording. You can find it on any streaming service or any CD as well. It's a really classic example of Dvorak from a Czech person who just has it in his blood. Had it, actually. He's no longer with us. Was Dvorak working in America a contributing factor to the Romantic National and folk music combination in the 20th century? A little bit, actually. You're thinking of Aaron Copland and Florence Price in particular. Florence Price, a little bit, because there was an influence there. She was influenced by what had been started at the National Conservatory, which wonderful, wonderful music that is being played more and more often, thank goodness. And also Aaron Copland took the idea, but it took him a bit longer to take that idea, because he actually, the beginning of his career, was composing a lot of what you expected from Viennese trained music. So a lot of 12 tone composition, a lot of atonal music. And then he decided to switch it when he got commissioned to play, to compose for ballets. And he wrote something that has become known as Americana, which he was one of the main focuses. So when we hear Copland, we think, oh, American music, but he was actually one of the ones that started that whole movement. So it was actually kind of a turned around in a little bit of a way. But you're right in that there was that influence, and at least the idea was planted. But at the same time, Aaron Copland, yes, he used always a sort of Western tradition to use that. But thanks for bringing that up, Kelly. There's definitely some connection there. Yeah. Well, thanks, everyone. We'll meet next week and explore some more romantic music. Have a great week, and we'll see you next week. Bye-bye.